Good day, viewers, and thank you once again for joining us for the Evening Review. I'm Ashley Smith, the news editor of Namibian Sun. In the studio today is popular democratic movement leader McHenry Venaani, who spoke to our political journalist Jemima Bukas about two very hard-hitting and interesting stories on our front page today, as well as on a range of other issues. This is what Honourable Venaani had to say.
Good day, viewers. My name is Jemima Bukas from Namibian Sun newspaper. Today we have in the studio with us the leader of the official opposition, Mr. McHenry Venaani. Good afternoon,
Mr. Good afternoon, Jemima. Good afternoon.
The Namibian Sun has two very important issues or stories on our front page today. One is looking at the unemployment in the country and the so-called or the notorious Fishrot scandal. You've always pride yourself as being the shadow government, the government in waiting. What is the PDM's plans to deal with this crisis?
Well, the unemployment rate has been growing out of proportion over a number of years due to a lack of injection in the economy. The small and medium enterprises did not get enough support to be able to produce a necessary job, because it is the job of the private sector to create jobs, but it is the job of the government to create an enabling environment for the private sector or the SME to create jobs. One of the areas in which we have failed drastically to create enough necessary jobs is the agricultural sector. If you are listening to the world's economy today, whether at Davos, or Bloomberg, or various international platforms, people are talking about the fourth industrial revolution, which is the revolution of technology and information. But Africa, and Namibia in particular, has not survived or not achieved the benefits of the second industrial revolution, which is agricultural mechanization and modernization. If you do not put enough investment in agriculture, if you look at the investment that is currently being invested in agriculture, is too little. People in the northern areas receive good rains, but they are still plowing with oxen, they are still plowing with donkeys, and they don't have mechanized agriculture, they don't have new technology. So our attack on joblessness in this country is to create the necessary infrastructural support for the agricultural sector to create food security and to create a number of jobs. Second with that is the structure of our economy, that our countries, third world countries, and in particular African countries, are extractive commodities. We are imbued with 30% of the world natural resources, but yet value addition is not something that we give attention to. Our zinc is produced in Rospina, but we just produce it to a certain level, and then the melting and all the rest of the processes starts in South Africa. So our plan is to create support incentives for companies that are going to do value addition, because if you do not add value to the commodities that your country is producing, you will not create the necessary jobs. How long have we been producing copper in Tumip and in various other mines, and yet we are selling to South Africa for South Africa for us to repurchase copper wires in South Africa? Why can't we manufacture those copper wires here? So we need to create a necessary enabling environment to have it to fix the mismatch in our economy, that most of our commodities are leaving our shores unprocessed, and being unprocessed, it denies the people, and especially the young people of this country, the job opportunities. Now, one can always argue to say that, do you have the human resource capacity to be able to add value? I'm saying yes. We have done so well in creating enough skills in terms of vocational training, but those skills are idling in Karatura, they're idling in Blachter, they're idling everywhere. People are not getting jobs. And then the other issue that needs to be attacked from our point of view is to change the procurement rules. We are giving too much procurement to big multinational companies, and the young people, the SMEs, are not getting support. So what we are saying is that in the procurement laws, you must create a 35% threshold, that all procurement that happens in Karas region, for example, 35% of those procurement should go to companies that are coming from there, so that you create in-house capacity where these tenders are being executed. Most of the time is to look at the construction industry. We have killed the construction industry because we have given all the tenders to Chinese, And what we have done with it is that we are bringing people that are partnering these international multinationals, and they are just getting offcuts. They get 25 million and the 1 billion go to Chinese. If you do not unbundle your procurement to make sure that if I have a tender of 1 billion, I give the tiling to Jemima, I give the flooring to another company, I give, by sharing that procurement, you make sure that more and more companies can be able to create jobs. So we have not created the necessary jobs in this country because we have looked the Chinese way, we have looked at the multinationals, we have looked at the big guys. We have concentrated on making people big multimillionaires instead of sharing real wealth amongst our people.
Speaking about unemployment and multinationals, we've seen the latest suspect arrested in the Fishrot scandal, the Fishrot CEO yesterday. And you've also written, the PDM has written a letter to the implicated Icelandic fishing company, Sameri, asking them to pay back or remunerate fishermen who has lost their jobs as a result of this Fishrot scandal. Have you received any feedback?
We haven't received. I mean, they are running a very silent strategy, saying that they are going to deal with their retrenched laborers, but they have not written back to us. We are already speaking to some goodwill lawyers in Iceland itself to see whether we can prosecute them either in Iceland or here. But we have also exerted pressure because we have used a multi-pronged strategy. We are exerting pressure through the Prosecutor General. We have written to the Prosecutor General and the ACC. And the Prosecutor General luckily has acted on freezing some of the assets. We want them to do more. But so our multi-pronged approach is really giving results, and we have not ended here. We would see what further steps will the Prosecutor General takes. If she doesn't take the matter to court, we are considering that option, and it is still on the cards to say that the Prosecutor General is not going to take this matter further, we are going to take it further.
Speaking about results, the PDM has managed to triple its presence in the National Assembly in the last election. You now have 16 seats. Now, would you attribute this to merit, or do you think Dr. Pandeleni Itula, the former presidential independent candidate, has also played a role by asking some of his supporters to rather vote for opposition political parties?
Well, I think we attribute that primarily to merit. The call for opposition support created a number of parties that would not have made them on their own to come to the fourth. I mean, we have seen some parties that never had a single rally under a tree getting two seats and three seats. Perhaps those parties can, and they made a deal with him and they got those seats. But we attribute it to the mood of the country. There was a mood of change. And because of the work that we have put in terms of motions that we brought to Parliament, in terms of the issues that we raised, we were the natural recipients of a no swap of vote, and the results prove that if it was a matter of that we got the spoil of all opposition, we could have shared that spoil across parties. We are the second largest party that is closer to us is four times smaller than us. So if it was a Dr. Itula factor, it could have contributed. There is relevance to say that there are people that were disillusioned in Swapo and they tend to vote for the largest opposition, and that is just a reality. But Dr. Itula got 30% of the vote, 29% of the vote, and we only got 16. So it tells you that there were also people that were nostalgic, that remained within the fold of the ruling party and didn't vote for us. So, and we didn't have a deal, unfortunately, with Dr. Itula prior to the election. So we cannot claim that we were recipients of their votes directly, but we were a recipient of a mood swing that was in the country. And we were reading it very clinically and very well, that our strategy was based on the mood of the country. And we knew that we were filling stadiums in areas where we couldn't fill them in the last 10 years. We could fill up Oshakati, to my surprise, we could fill up Luderitz. So the mood was changing, and we have created, playing a role in changing that mood over a number of efforts that we have put on the ground. And our strategy was second to none. Our political visibility was second to none. Our consistent fight in the National Assembly was second to none. So those things really played in our favor. And going forward, we are going to build on that foundation. One of the things that are lacking in the current National Assembly is the fact that Parliament is not really accountable. The legislature is over-dominated by the executive. We hope now that the President has agreed with us that he needs to make his cabinet smaller, that the legislature would have a much more greater role to play. For example, a motion that is adopted in the National Assembly does not necessarily have direct applicability to government. It ought to have, but SWAPO would say they would accept a motion in the National Assembly, but they would not act on it. So the legislature is left weak. We do not have, one of the issues that we are fighting strongly about is to have a budget committee, because you cannot deal with the implementation of the budget without a committee, because you only deal with policy issues, fighting the budget on the floor of the House. But what you need a robust budget committee that looks at every cent, that the cent that we are spending in education, does it give value for money? The cent that we are spending on health, the cent that we spend on sanitation, and reallocating these things. So we are hoping now, with the numbers that we have, and working with other opposition forces in the country, to make sure that we create a robust synergy to make sure that legislators' job is to change the lives of the people. And PDM is going to come to the fore, bringing in motions, and not only motions now, because of resources that we are going to get quadrupled, is the fact that we are going to really focus on fighting the ruling party on legislation level, because there are a number of legislations that never comes to the floor of the House. One of the issues is the issue of the information bill. Information bill was promulgated in 2007, but it has not seen the light of the day. So we are going to push for a private members bill. That if the ruling party is slacking behind in bringing bills to the House, we are going to jump the gun and bring bills for tabling for them to be debated. Of course, you need a strong lobbying ground. We are creating an internal research unit already in the PDM. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to visit IPPR just to look at what they are doing and the good work that they are doing. So we are investing heavily on a robust, modern parliamentary season that we want to see things changing, because the whole world, the citizenry of the world, and here in Namibia, have lost confidence in politicians, and they are right by losing confidence in us. Look at the numbers of people, the number of people that went to the polls. Out of the problems that this country was facing, we had a very highly contested election, but only less than 65% of people went to the votes. What happened to the 37%? People have no interest in politics. And why don't they have interest in politics? Because politicians are spending a lot of time debating about their allergies, debating about their own problems, as opposed to problems that are going to be game changers, changing the lives of the people. Now, the issues of sanitation, issues of information dissemination bill, issues of gender parity, issues of income, basic income grant, reforming our health sector, the education sector, we should hone in on these issues. And I wish that parliamentarians that are coming to the National Assembly, both from both sides of the divide, will make their time and energy focusing on those issues that changes the lives of our people. Because if you look at what Parliament debates most of the time, and look at the breaks that we have, I've been consistently fighting the parliamentary system, that we need to reform and overhaul our parliamentary system. You can't have a parliamentary system where you have 6 months, people are on leave, and we are blaming that, no, Parliament has committee system. The committee system in Parliament is falling apart. The reason why it is falling apart is that the ruling party is consistently putting people to chair committees that are not capable of chairing them and be able to change the direction. And now, with the numbers that we have and the control that we have in the backbenching role of politics, we are going to make sure that we are going to hold government to account. We're going to proactively and reactively focus on all those issues that we think it is important, because when you are the official opposition, you need to be reactive, because government dictates the agenda of the day, and you are a reactive force to make sure that whatever they are doing is in the broader interest of society. And we are going to do more to hold government to account. For example, we have never addressed the question of the effectiveness of the Auditor General. Reports are being tabled there. So every institution of government, and especially your institutions that are supposed to really focus on bringing matters to the fore. Look at the ACC. You had a director, Noah, who goes on a WhatsApp or SWAPO group and says that this Fishrot scam, there is no evidence. Primarily, that's where it started. But Parliament has not questioned him that. Why are you as a director on a WhatsApp group of a political party and saying these things? And those are the issues that Parliament need to do. We need to call in the Prosecutor General to commit to committees, and she must account. Why are you taking long to freeze the assets of the Samherji company? People need to be accounted, to be accountable, and we are going to lead a force that is going to make government to account. And we are going to do so with all other actors. We would wish to work with all the 34 opposition forces in order to make sure that we keep government to account, and we also bring motions and private members' bills that addresses issues that affects our society.
Speaking about accountability, can you please clarify the issue around the party's party list to the National Assembly, and have you had time to have you given feedback to the disgruntled members?
Well, we are about to give feedback. You see, primarily we are on record, and we have been bona fide on this matter. We think and we know that the law that was promulgated by Parliament is unconstitutional, and we are going to prove that. We just came from the Electoral Tribunal that referred us to the High Court, and we are about to go to the High Court to prove that, because the law says if you want to stand as a candidate, you should not earn 2 salaries. But we are saying you cannot earn a salary. Even people that are elected on the list are not earning a salary until they are sworn in. Now, the Constitution of our Republic under Schedule 4, Subsection 4 is very clear that it remains within the ambit of political parties to choose their representative. We have been bona fide from the beginning. Before we knew how many seats we were going to get, we were fighting ECN, and we are the only party that was consistently fighting ECN, saying that the way that you're implementing this law is contrary to the constitutional provision of the country. Again, the democratic process of the party must be respected. It is the duties and the purpose and the reason of the existence of parties to choose their representative. The party central committee and the electoral college chose certain representative. They were denied their right because the law was misquoted and people were using the law to the letter in a very wrong way. And we are saying those members, the 4 members, we are saying to them, and we have been consistently saying that they did not arrive at those numbers through merit. They arrived there because their jobs were not affected. And we are saying, for us to balance the party, it is very cardinal to my leadership that we cannot have an overrepresentation of one ethnic group over the other in large numbers. We cannot have an overrepresentation. People are saying we voted for a youth list. And this is the very reason why we want to amend it, is because we knew that more people wanted more young people to come to the fore. And this list, if we implement it in the current way, we are denying the question of ethnic balancing and tribal balancing internally in the party, and we are bringing more older people, because we put older people lower on the list primarily to balance and to bring more young people to the fore. So we are doing all these things to make sure that the ethos and values of internal democracy remain consistent. Those members were told, they knew their numbers. Some of them were sitting in the results center. There are communications between us knowing their numbers, and we are saying that yes, ECN pushed us into this corner. And we are saying the priority lies with the party. I'm the president of the party. And if PDM decides today that Venaani is not doing a great job to the party, even if I was elected by Congress, even if I was nominated by the party to be number one, they can remove me. And we are seeing a plethora of examples globally where a person who's a sitting prime minister, where is David Cameron? Where is the last lady who was the prime minister of England? People that were legitimately elected. Parties, always, it is in the nature and the DNA of political parties, they need to bring people that would represent them. So on this matter, we are going to win, because the power lies with the party to decide on their representative. And those members, those 4 members knew why their names were taken to the fore. It's not that they did not know. It's not, they were not taken by surprise. We took everybody into confidence, saying that ECN is forcing us. And the last day that we had to amend that list, we wrote a letter, and that's why the legal opinion that ECN got supported our view, because we wrote and we said that we are going to amend this letter under duress, because the way that you're implementing the law is unconstitutional, and we took processes to courts. So why did we go to court if we didn't have, if we're not bona fide? It's not that we don't want the people on the list. We knew the problems that it would create, and we were consistent in that process, and we are going to be vindicated.
Okay. Dr. Panduleni Itula has returned to the Supreme Court following its ruling in the challenge against the use of the EVMs. Last time we spoke, you said you will study the papers. Have you been studying
the papers? Yes, we have been studying the paper. The most dangerous, I agree with Dr. Itula, saying that I was taken by surprise by the judiciary that they took a unanimous decision. Now, in the law of unanimous decision, it is, when you review a unanimous decision, it becomes very difficult. But that's a matter of another day. But I think, and I agree with Dr. Itula, that the judgment or the verdict that we got was an error of law, because you can't say the process that brings a certain person or a certain elected leaders to the fore is unconstitutional, and yet you legitimize that. Now, they could argue and say that had we gone the route of illegitimizing the process, then we would have ought to have legitimized all the other processes retrospectively. But I would have argued that why illegitimize the whole process? Why not the current election? That is questionable. In question. So I agree with him that there is a need to review. But whether the success, it has to do with hindsight and experience that we have gained all over this matter. We are not a new party. We are 40 plus years old in the country. We have gone to courts, and we know that our judiciary, unfortunately, always rule cases on petty technicalities as opposed to the fundamental cases. Now, this case was thrown out. The re-election was not granted on technicalities, because the judge says, so wrongly says, you have not showed cause to have proven that you were against EVMs. So where was the judge when we wrote letters to ministers? Where was the judge when these motions were debated in parliament? I mean, the whole 2019 election was preceded by the fight. Since 2017, we have been fighting about EVMs, unconstitutionality of EVMs. So for the court to have said that you have not showed cause that you were fighting this thing, it's not our problem. It is the problem of the implementing authority to implement the law according to the letter and spirit of the Constitution. Now, if money was wasted, who wasted the money? It is the same government that didn't implement the law. So why would you exonerate them from saying that election is going to cost a lot of money and therefore we would allow future elections to be? I agree with Dr. Itula, but whether he's going to be successful in reviewing the judgment where you had a unanimous decision, that is also a difficult point to prove, because it's very difficult. And if you look at precedent cases across the globe and where you have persuasive jurisdictions across the globe, you have never succeeded. The very minimal cases where you had a unanimous bench taking a decision, and upon review you could be successful. So it's a tough one. It's much more trickier than the first one. But I am saying that our judiciary was persuaded by other jurisdiction. Had we not had a judgment in Kenya, had we not had a judgment in Malawi, had we not had a judgment in India and Germany over the EVMs, we wouldn't have gotten here. So our judiciary should be questioned. And I disagree with them saying that we must be hands off to question what they are doing. I think our judiciary have a role to play in our country, but they should not wait. We shouldn't have a judiciary that waits until all other jurisdictions persuasively informs them. Because had we not had those judgments, this case would have been thrown away on any other technical matter that you were supposed to come on 5 o'clock and you came at 6 o'clock. So I believe that the judiciary needs to really pull up their socks. Mm-hmm. They are working in the interest. And one of the issues that is very fundamental about the judiciary is the income of judges. If you look at what our judges are receiving and are earning, they are earning, some of them are earning more than the president. So they are sitting in a comfortable situation. I'm very inclined to say that many of them are captured because they are receiving good salaries, and they don't want to rule anything against the government, because no other person can persuasively argue that yes, you say a process is illegal, yet it is legitimate. You can't have both. You can't have it both. It's either it's legal or it's not legal. So I think that our judiciary should come under a stronger review, and we will debate even the salaries of judges in Parliament.
Thank you very much for joining us, Mr. Venaani. Thank you very much, viewers, for tuning in.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for joining us for today's edition of The Evening Review. Please join us tomorrow once again for an interesting program. I'm Ashley Smith, the news editor of Namibian Sun.